Hi everyone, today we'll be discussing the impact of abnormal kidney development on chronic kidney disease. To begin, let's go over some basic anatomy. The kidneys are vital organs that regulate fluid, electrolyte, and acid-base balance in our bodies. It is in the kidneys that blood is filtered of all waste, and this waste is excreted as urine. The kidney contains millions of these tiny structures. What are these structures? This is the nephron, and the nephron is a functional unit of the kidney, where the kidney performs its function of blood filtration. The focus of this video will be on one specific part of the nephron, the glomerulus, and the glomerulus is a network of small blood vessels where the filtration of the blood actually occurs. Abnormal development, as we will learn later on, of the nephron can lead to kidney disease. Let's discuss a bit of background on chronic kidney disease next. As mentioned previously, the main functions of the kidneys are to filter waste from the blood, produce urine, and maintain blood pressure. In chronic kidney disease, our kidneys are damaged and are unable to filter blood the way they are supposed to. This results in the accumulation of waste in our bodies. It is referred to as chronic kidney disease because this damage can occur slowly over a long period of time, typically persisting for more than 3 months. Some of the symptoms of advanced chronic kidney disease can include chest pain, swelling, nausea, cramps. In extreme cases, the disease can worsen and possibly lead to kidney failure. Chronic kidney disease is diagnosed through analysis of blood and urine tests. It's possible to not present any symptoms associated with chronic kidney disease, as your kidneys can be doing just enough to keep you feeling healthy despite the damage. For this reason, the best way to know whether you have kidney disease is by getting blood and urine tests done. This graphic from the National Kidney Foundation depicts the various stages of chronic kidney disease. If results show that you have a glomerular filtration rate, which is just kidney filtration rate, of less than 60, or you have high levels of substances such as proteins in your blood, you are diagnosed with chronic kidney disease. A glomerular filtration rate below 15 indicates kidney failure. Now let's discuss the causes of chronic kidney disease. Hypertension, or high blood pressure, can be a cause for kidney disease as the pressure damages small blood vessels in your kidneys. Another high-risk group for developing chronic kidney disease is individuals with diabetes, as excessive glucose can damage the filters in the kidneys. However, other such causes, such as glomerular sclerosis, which involves the scarring and hardening of the glomerulus, can also influence the onset of this disease. There are some genetic risk factors as well. Chronic kidney disease has a relatively high heritability of 30-75%, meaning that a large amount of the differences seen in those with kidney disease versus without can be attributed to genes. Sickle cell trait, another genetic condition, has also been associated with higher risks of kidney disease. There are still many other factors which can affect chronic kidney disease progression. These include heart disease, stroke, family history, obesity, tobacco use, and age. The one cause of particular interest to us is abnormal kidney development. Treatment options for chronic kidney disease target the cause of the kidney damage and aim to slow its progression into kidney failure. In less severe cases, lifestyle changes are recommended to maintain the best health. Some examples of this include diet and exercise changes. Medications that deal with some of the problems associated with chronic kidney disease can also be used to slow its progression. In chronic kidney disease patients with hypertension, medication to manage high blood pressure is common. In severe cases of chronic kidney disease where it becomes kidney failure, a patient would either need dialysis treatment, which helps to remove waste from the blood using a machine, or an organ transplant. Now that we've covered the basics of chronic kidney disease, let's discuss the basics of abnormal kidney development. Several issues can arise during kidney development, ranging from very severe to subtle structural changes of the kidney. In about 1 in 500 births, some abnormality occurs in the development of the kidneys or urinary tract, and this is a quote from the National Kidney Foundation. Structural changes of the kidney can be broken down into macro and micro anatomical changes. Some examples of macro anatomical kidney structural changes include duplicated ureters, where instead of one tube draining the kidney to the bladder, there are now two. It includes renal agenesis, which is where you were either born with only one functional kidney or zero. And it includes multicystic kidney, which is where multiple cysts form on the kidney due to nephrons filling with urine. Macro changes can be spotted at birth with ultrasound. Doctors can treat these abnormalities if caught early and reduce the risk of disease. The National Kidney Foundation states that babies with urinary tract abnormalities detected by prenatal ultrasound often do very well. There was also a second class of anatomical changes, which are a lot harder to spot. Microanatomical changes are difficult to notice in their early stages. Some examples of them include nephron endowment, which is the number of functional nephrons at birth, and this is a number that is affected by birth weight. Another example is glomerular sclerosis, which is the scarring and hardening of the glomeruli, and this can lead to protein in the urine. Another example is abnormal glomerular genesis, which simply put is the abnormal formation of the glomeruli. Over time, the effects of the microanatomical abnormalities compound and become more pronounced. Chronic kidney disease is a long-term disease characterized by the lack of kidney function. You can begin to see the picture of how these small changes compound over the years, contributing more and more to decreased kidney function and eventually chronic kidney disease. Several different factors have been shown to contribute to abnormal kidney development. During fetal development, negative events can have an impact on kidney development. For instance, low birth weight and prematurity have been associated with low nephron count and increase in risk of hypertension and kidney disease later in life. Notably, the health and diet of the mother during pregnancy can contribute to abnormal kidney development. A second potential factor that leads to abnormal kidney development is genetics. During the development of the kidneys, interactions between specific types of cells leads to the formation of the nephrons. Genetic mutations can affect these interactions and result in lower nephron counts. A third factor in kidney development is postnatal nutrition, or simply put, the nutrition of the child following birth. Studies have shown that overeating or diets with excessive protein for children can lead to chronic kidney disease later in life. Now that we've discussed the background of both topics, let's connect them using a fictional story. Here is Betty. Growing up, Betty had no macroanatomical kidney changes. During the routine ultrasound exam given before birth, Betty's organs seemed perfectly fine. What could not be observed in the ultrasounds, however, is the decreased nephron count and the presence of scarred glomeruli. These abnormalities were the result of genetic factors. As Betty grew up, she was unaware of the microchanges to her kidney. Her diet was high in salt and sugar, which is an added risk factor for chronic kidney disease. The symptoms of chronic kidney disease were not yet present as the effects of the decreased nephron count are still compounding with age. The functional parts of Betty's kidneys are under more stress as compared to someone with a perfectly normal kidney at her age. Betty was still unaware of her kidney changes growing up due to the slow onset of chronic kidney disease. Up until adulthood, Betty rarely got her blood and urine tests done. One day, during a visit to the doctors complaining of nausea and swelling, Betty gets a blood test done after the suggestion from her doctor. The tests revealed that she has stage 2 chronic kidney disease. Betty's doctor recommends lifestyle changes to put less strain on her kidney. He also recommends a diet that will drastically slow the progression of chronic kidney disease. What lessons can we take away from Betty's situation? Well, had Betty gotten these blood and urine tests done on an annual basis, the doctor could have recommended these lifestyle changes before the drop in kidney function. Early intervention can significantly slow the progression of chronic kidney disease. As for how frequently you should be getting these tests done, you should consult your family physician for that. The second lesson we can learn is that of maintaining a balanced diet. Diets high in salt and sugar can lead to hypertension and diabetes, which, as we have learned, are risk factors for chronic kidney disease. Maintaining a healthy, balanced diet is beneficial to all organ systems, not just the kidneys. And that concludes our talk. Thanks for watching.